Don't be cussing, I'm just gonna make.
I'm trying to eat my drinks.
I'm gonna get mad at AT&T.
Yeah, that's a message.
No.
I dwell on that. I get more mad.
Rested in your table.
I don't carry mine.
And I was supposed to. But it doesn't people know about.
Yeah, well, it's right at the. Meeting will come to order. Please shut off all your cell phones. We will stand for prayer and pledge of allegiance.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for another beautiful day that you've given us, Lord. Lord, we just look to you for guidance as we make decisions. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us, Lord. And Lord, I just ask you to follow all of us home and get us home safely tonight as we go our own ways. In your precious holy name I pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the first item is approval of the minutes from 3-7-2017. Do I have a motion to approve?
Motion.
Got a motion? Got a second? Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Approval of the claims. Do I have a motion to approve the claims? Got a motion? Do I have a second? Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Approval of SRF claim.
Yeah, I do have a claim to be paid from SRF funds for Strand and Associates. It's for the water tank rehab for February service in the amount of $10,522.40.
Projected time frame on that? Is that spring or fall?
I don't think that's, I think that's a topic for tonight actually. Is that?
Okay. Do I have a motion to approve SRF claim?
I'll move.
Got a second. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Old business. Project update, the lovely Trina Carter.
Thank you, sir. Excuse me, good evening. A lot of the projects are currently underway, so I'll kind of go over these briefly and then defer to later items in the agenda as far as more specific reports. For the drinking water project, the one that involved the community development block grant, final community development block grant request for funds has been submitted. And then the remaining SRF funding, I believe, is on the agenda with Strand for later. The town hall, town manager Doan is gathering input from the committee, and then upon gathering of all that information, we'll schedule a meeting with RQAW and the town hall committee. Again, we're keeping USDA in the loop should we move forward with funding for that. Hope Main Street, I believe, Susan Thayer Five will probably be providing some updates there. I can update you on the initial draw of the 60% of the funds for the grant program. And I believe we also have Nick Starro and John Casella here to update everyone on what is going on there. We're still keeping our, I guess we're still looking to potentially apply for facade renovation money from the downtown enhancement grant. And so we will keep updating you on that. I'll be working with Main Street and potentially with Starro and Casella on that, as I believe they're probably highlighting that in a portion of their planning grant plan. The fire department, I'm not aware that they've heard anything regarding the personal protective equipment at this point in time.
Not yet.
Right, okay. I'm ready to just confirm that. And then we're still keeping our eyes open for anything that is appropriate for the town of Hope. And we are remaining still taking applications for the owner-occupied program, for the aging in place. We currently have two applications in-house, but we'll need a minimum of 10 to 15 homeowners applications in order to apply for that program. So if you know someone or have friends or a neighbor who would qualify for that program, we have applications here, or you could have them call our office and we could send them that information as well. We need to have that information by mid-May, no later than for the next council meeting in May, by I would say the 15th or so, unless that's the weekend. But anyway, so mid-May is when we need to have all that information to us so we can compile and make a competitive application. I also wanted to make sure that everyone was aware, council and town manager and clerk treasurer, that, and also Susan, if you're interested, you're invited to the ERA annual meeting. Our topic this year is placemaking in Indiana. We have speakers coming from the Indiana Housing and Community Development Authority regarding our placemaking Indiana and creating, which the IN is capitalized, places. Also, we have Colette Childress from the Office of Community and Rural Affairs. And then we have a couple of others. One is Healthy by Design. Kate Reardon is coming from the Alliance for Health Promotion and Arts in Placemaking from the Indiana Arts Commission. So I have a few invitations, so you're all invited. I will leave these on the table, and if you so choose, please come. It is May 10th, it's a Wednesday, from 11 until 2. We need an RSVP by May 1st. Yes, sir?
Are you feeding everybody?
We do need an RSVP by May 1st because we do provide a lunch. Okay? Thank you.
Here's the invitation. If you want to take one, that's one. That'd be great. JT and Diane.
Okay, water project update. Grant.
All right, thanks. My name is Tony Akers with Strand Associates, and this is the waterline project update. Basically, the waterline project is done, but we're in the warranty period, so everything's warming up. And so in front of you, I passed out a list. You'll see a list of addresses. What this is Steve Robertson went around the town late last week and over the weekend and looked for areas that need either reseeded or regraded, where they're rough or whatever. So this is a preliminary list that we've come up with so far. We haven't shared this with David for obvious reasons. We'll get him to him later this week. But we'll want to get him to Lykins. Lykins is the contractor, probably early next week, so they can come in, finish everything up, reseed whatever they need to do. We'd like to get him to them all at one time. That way they come back. It'll probably take them a couple days at the most to kind of regrade and reseed everything. But I want to give everybody a list so you can kind of see the areas that we're looking at. And like I said, we'll get a list of this to Dave, and he can add to it. But like I said, this is preliminary. And then I want to try to get it to Lycans early next week and get them in here and finish everything up. And that'll have everything finished up for the waterline project. So, any questions?
Water tower update. JT and Strand.
Yes, good evening, Honorable Town Council members. Before you is a tab that has information. For you is a tab that has information that pertains to the bids that were received on the water tower. I'll let Tony kind of go into some detail with that. Strand was here, did open those sealed bids. On the water tower, at this point before you tonight, Council, it is a decision. Obviously, the bidding was made towards one, whether we do a total project, total paint and Rico, which would put us out 20 to 25 years that our water tower would be taken care of. And they also submitted the bidding to do an alternate, which is something that would get us through for the next 10 to 15 years. It's my recommendation to the council that we proceed forward with the total project, so that way we have our water tower taken care of for the next 20 to 25 years. The funding there through SRF is available to cover the project. So that would be my first recommendation in terms of the water tower. I don't know if Council President, if you would like to go ahead and entertain a motion in that regard, or if you'd like me to proceed forward with the next topic.
I'd like to hear these bids because and let him explain that some of them were not done correctly enough so that everybody understands that.
Okay. I will allow Tony Akles with Strand to go into further detail about those bids that were received. The other recommendation that I have, again, the first, that we do proceed forward with the total project to get our water tower taken care of for the next 20, 25 years. And the second, we have either an option to do a spring paint or a fall paint. Right now, given the timing, and I have communicated with Verizon and kept them apprised, I do think a spring paint could be some challenges time-wise with us being able to get Verizon to get their antennas down from the tower. And also too, in the spring, we're gonna be having some days, obviously with Mother Nature, that we will not be able to, you know, have non-work days. So it's my recommendation also that we move forward with a fall paint. So that will allow for more time for Verizon to get their antennas removed, and then also allow for probably more consistent work days in the fall. So those are my recommendations. I'll now turn it over to Tony Akles.
All right, thanks, JT. There were some irregularities in the bid when they came in. We had 9 bidders, which was great. Had a lot of interest in the project. We took the bids back like we always would do and reviewed them, and we realized that the 2 lowest bidders had problems with their bid. The lowest bidder had a lot of problems. He was missing like four items that, according to Indiana law, says must accompany a bid. Okay, so we talked to Cindy, and she came to our office, and we talked it over, and we actually talked to SRF as well. And the recommendation from everybody was really that those bids have to be considered what is called non-responsive. They didn't include enough information to make them a complete bid. Like one of them, you know, they didn't have a sealed bid bond. They didn't have a drug testing program. They didn't acknowledge some addendum and stuff like that. There were some that were actually on the higher end of the bid that didn't include some stuff as well. They didn't include their drug testing policy, so we had to throw them out. So out of the 9, we were left with, I think, 3. 3 bids. So we, like I say, we talked to Cindy and we talked to SRF, and our recommendation, I know Cindy's recommendation, is to go with what would have been the third lowest bidder, which is now the lowest bidder because we threw the 2 lowest ones out, which is Kearns Construction Services. So if you look at this page right here, the first one, they had everything in order. So the base bid for them is $103,350. And then we had some alternates, and we have alternate one, alternate two, alternate three, and alternate four. So alternate one and two is to do the full blast and recode of the exterior, along with the full blast and recode of the interior, that is the base bid. And then alternates three and four were just to do some spot blasting and painting of the exterior, not a full blast and repaint. So if you add the $103,350 and $176,750, you come up with $280,100. That was below our estimate, and as JT says, we're recommending that you do both the inside and the outside. That's going to get you 20 plus years, and that's within the funding of SRF. If everything goes right and you don't have any change orders, you're probably going to end up with a few thousand dollars left over, and maybe buy some water meters or something with. And then alternative one was for the spring, and alternative two was for the fall, and you can see they priced them both the same. So there's not any cost difference between the fall and spring, but as JT mentioned too, we're getting pretty close on the spring painting with all the spring rains and all that. Really, fall's a better time, and that will occur. Usually, it'll start after Labor Day. It's when kind of everything, all the water usage kind of winds down a little bit, because they will have to take the water tower out of service for a while. So, in a nutshell, we had a good bid, but we just had some bidders that were out of state that didn't understand the Indiana bidding laws, and they just didn't include everything in their bid. And it's unfortunate, but Indiana law is pretty clear that you have to consider them non-responsive, and you kind of have to throw them out. So, any questions on that?
Do you have any idea on this little bit, or do you know their work or anything like that?
No, we have not worked with them before. We did kind of check some of their projects. They've done, like, I think around 40 or 50 water towers. That's quite a bit. We haven't personally worked with them. There are quite a few water tank painters around, and when you get to that level of experience, they're usually in pretty good shape, you know. The first low bidder, I was a little nervous about, so I wasn't too upset that we had to throw them out, because they hadn't done any water towers, and they were very low, you know. So at that point, I was worrying, and then when we realized they left a lot of stuff out, we're like, okay, this is enough, you know, kind of over-ing. But Kearns, out of Kentucky, there's a lot of them out of Kentucky, there's some out of Michigan and stuff. I'd say we haven't personally worked with them, but in looking at the resume and stuff, and they painted the towers here in Indiana. They did one for Patriot and one for, I can't remember where it is now, but we went and kind of looked at it, and everything seemed fine. And they're not having any issues. They've been painted for a few years, so I don't think we'll have any issue with them.
All these bids come with a bond, so if they're not able to complete the work,
They come with a bid bond, so if they don't honor their bid, we can call their bid bond. But then as part of the contract, they have to provide a performance and a payment bond, both. So if they don't perform, you can call their bond on that. And if they don't pay, like their subs, which they won't have that many subs, they're painters, then you can go after their payment bond if they don't do that. So between that and the insurance, everything is pretty well covered.
Have so many work days in this, it's listed in it, is it?
Yep, let me get to my brother with me. From the time we give notice to proceed, so if we go in the fall, like we're recommending after Labor Day, we give them 90 calendar days to what we call substantial completion, and then another 20 days after that, so 110 days total to do the cleanup and any final, you know, cleanup and stuff that they have to have, so 110 days to the end of it. We normally paint water towers in the fall, and it's plenty of time, but it'll take them a good 90 days to kind of get stuff done and wrapped up and painted and all that stuff. So, and if they don't meet those, there are liquidated damages in the specs that the town could enforce if for some reason they drag their feet and they don't get done in time.
And people need to know that we will be feeding water from Miller Manor.
Mills Mary Manor, yeah.
So we're not going to be without water.
No. That was one of the reasons why we put that redundant feed in for Miller's Mary Manor in case something like this. We knew this would eventually happen. You might notice a slight decrease in pressure. Not that much. It was kind of like it was last fall. We were operating off Miller's Mary Manor before we had the other connection done. And most people probably didn't notice it because it actually operates off the tower there in
Hartsville.
Hartsville, there you go. Yeah, Steve's right here. So, yeah, you will not be without water.
So what's your pleasure?
I think we've got the money to do it. It looks to me, these bids, it looks like foolish if we don't go ahead and do it. I'll move that we go ahead and do the complete paint.
That's your motion?
Second.
Second. Any more discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries five oh.
And SRF is aware, we're just waiting on a letter from them because they're looking at the bids too, but they've indicated us that they're fine with what we did in terms of going, you know, having to fill a couple bidders out, but we're just waiting for that letter and we should be able to proceed pretty quickly after that. Thanks.
Good. Cyber liability, if you don't.
Yes, honorable council members, before you is a printout. Mr. Telto was at your March meeting, made a presentation about the importance of the town having a cyber liability in our coverage in case we would ever be hacked or someone was able to get a hold of, put some coverage on there for you know, information that we have, private information that might be out there. So before you is provided two quotes for cyber liability coverage of up to $1 million for the sum of $1,282, and provided an option for a $2 million limit for $1,666. That's my recommendation that we proceed forward with the $2 million limit coverage for the amount of $1,666 to ensure that we have some additional coverage there to protect the town.
What is the total premium stuff here? I don't understand that. That $44,675 is the total premium.
Councilmember Miller, do you have some thoughts on that?
The total premium, that's for the town insurance. That's for the total town insurance liability, and also for the coverage for the your police department, for all the property. So that's what that's for. The two figures you see on the bottom, the cyber liability, that's the two limits there. So we've already paid, or the town already paid the premium for the town. So this would be an additional.
So in other words, this premium is all our other insurances.
Yeah, that's already been paid.
The only question I have, it seems like we had something under cloud too that protected us from that.
And I did talk with Josh from CCI, and he did recommend, because of the fact that although they can immediately detect if someone hacks, they cannot prevent private records from still going out and getting a hold of that information. So he did recommend that we have coverage.
And this is for a year, or is that for a month?
That's for a year.
We checked into multiple companies or just the one, or I know someone talked with this last.
And the way that works.
That's what I thought was the same.
The way it works is it's an add-on to our current policy. So it wouldn't benefit us to try to have that quoted somewhere else. It's like having comp separate on your auto coverage. So
this is our current company.
Yes.
Okay. I haven't dealt with that yet. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't vote on this. Okay. Because I'm the agent of record.
So in other words, where Target got hacked and lost a lot of that stuff, this is what was covering them?
Yes. It would be liability protect all the town employees, all the town customers, and anybody that we have their personal information.
Okay.
So I'm sure we still retain personal information from people who have been previous customers. I don't know how much information we retain. But it's probably more than we should. But okay. The same way with violence, I have a lot of information.
Do we, in our regular insurance policy with them, do we have any coverage at all now?
Not for cyber.
None for cyber, no.
Well, I think it's becoming more and more apparent that it's being done, so I think we need to protect ourselves.
The philosophy today is it's not if you get hacked, it's when you get hacked.
I need a motion, either 1 million or 2 million.
Well, for no more difference in price, it's almost foolish not to go to 2 million. You're talking $300. $300.
Okay, I've got a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Got a second. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carries 5-0.
4-0.
4-0, excuse me. First mistake of the night.
Only one I know to get over, Mike.
No, no. I still got to
do the edit. Don't
tell me that. I still got to do the edit. Okay, animal control fees. Okay, Chief Jones, second reading.
Yes, Honorable Councilmember, before you is the ordinance 2017-04, which came before you at your March Town Council meeting for a first reading. There was a suggestion by Councilmember Meek that we clarify some of that language there in the first paragraph to specify that this is in regards to those that own the animals and are surrendering, you know, the animals that they own. And I appreciate Cindy. Cindy did make that clarification in that ordinance. So this ordinance is before you tonight on a second reading. And if you have any additional questions, we'd be glad to comment further.
I still have a question on this. This says 6-48. It says if any person contacts animal control for surrender of the animal, and the animal's owned by any person, surrender fee is $60. I thought that was what we were trying to clear up. That if her dog got on my place and I turned it in, I'm not gonna pay the bet.
I know the ordinance as it came in March did not have the indication of the ownership. I guess we could say the owned by. Do you have another suggestion for how we could work that?
I thought that's what we talked about at the last meeting, was to limit that.
Cindy, do you have any?
I need a copy of that to take a quick look at. Thank you.
Wow.
It ought to read, I see your point there, owned by that person.
Right.
So I think it's just changing the ante to that is what would get you where you want to be.
Mr. President, I move to table to the next meeting.
So table. Okay. Garbage and rubbish updates. Ordinance 2017-08.
Yes, I just wanted to provide the council with some updates on the ordinance 2017-08. Council approved at their March working session. Currently, that ordinance has gone very well. Building zoning administrator, I appreciate all his efforts. He tagged 8 homes here recently. 6 of those homes were responsive. The 2 that were not were subsequently issued a ticket from our town marshal. Both of those actually contacted me directly and asked what else they needed to do to get in compliance with that ordinance. So far that ordinance is going well. We do have some other homes listed that our building zoning administrator, Greg Potts, We'll be putting the, again, it's a red tag goes on the doorknob, a copy of the ordinance gets attached to the door, and the homeowner has 10 days to clean that up. I also created a spreadsheet so we would have to be able to track this. And so when our building zoning administrator or our town marshal, the case may be, is tagging these homes, I put that into a spreadsheet. And then, of course, mark out the date, 10 days from that date. And then any other activity that happens, I make sure to note that as well. We actually had one individual that contacted us and said that he was willing to clean up. He just is not health-wise able. And so I reached out and got a couple contacts for him to try to remedy that. So that's the updates that I have at this time on this ordinance. Is there any other questions from the town council?
I think it's been highly successful so far.
Sounds like he's done a good job. So.
Is this the time that we would go over Craig's activity report also? Have you read
it?
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. If you went away, we'll wait until the end.
Okay, I would rather.
Okay.
Any other questions about this? Thank you, JT.
Okay, thank you.
New business, downtown revitalization plan update. Meg Starrow and John Casella.
My name is Meg Starrow. I think in your packets you have an abbreviated version of the options for discussion that were discussed at a public workshop on March 30th. We just wanted to make sure that the town council knew what was being discussed and what some of those ideas that have been talked about were. What the scope of the planning process has been to this date. And I thought I could go through those. I apologize that I don't have them for the screen. We're having another, let me make a chance here to advertise that we're having another public meeting at the end of this month, April 27th at 6 o'clock, so you can certainly come and see updated ideas at that time. So just to refresh your memory, the downtown revitalization plan is focused on the town square and one block off of the town square. It's a planning process that is looking at a range of issues that have been identified by the Main Street Committee, the Main Street of Hope Committee, which is new executive director, Susan Therify, is here tonight. And we're in the sort of two-thirds through our process at this point. We've had multiple meetings with our Main Street Committee, and we've had separate meetings with what we call focus group meetings or subject experts on various topics like possible or understanding the different events that are going on at the town square and what their needs are for facilities. We've had focus groups on sort of discussing what the culture is of Hope, making sure that we're hearing people talk about what the important values are for the community. So in response to that, and also what their concerns are. We've been hearing a lot of concerns, and that was the main topic at this public meeting, was reviewing some initial thoughts where we compiled a lot of these ideas and concerns that we've heard and are proposing certain remedies that we want to hear comments on. So the first one in your packet is sort of an illustrative concept for possible improvements to the town square itself. There's a lot of possibilities out there that we heard. For instance, that the shelter needs new shingles. We heard that the town square is dark at night, that everybody loves the town square, but they'd like to be able to use it for additional purposes, like if their child was at a playground, could there be restrooms, for instance, so they didn't have to run to town hall or the local gas station. So what we've done is heard a lot of those concerns and goals, and have made some sketches of what some of the answers could be or some of the possibilities could be. We've shown that the shelter could, if funds are available and if the grant is available, could accommodate new restrooms with a small addition that would be added on to the, so the east side of the shelter. It would require a new sewer line, obviously, which will be expensive, so we'll have to find money if that is something that the town chooses to go ahead with. We've also shown a outdoor terrace area on the south side of the shelter, and that does two things. It starts to integrate into an overall walkway in the town square that connects the shelter, the bandstand, and the playground to the parking areas and to each other. And we're envisioning this could be a nice paving, attractive, but also able to take wheelchairs or rolling equipment, so it would be ADA accessible. So this outdoor terrace would integrate into that and allow for additional seating for events, and for tiered method to have a place, in addition to the existing benches, a method for people to sit and watch their children in the playground. In addition, we've observed that there's probably a need for people that rent the shelter or use the shelter for the events to get their equipment and, not equipment, but supplies, I guess, for their event up to the shelter. And so we're thinking that on a temporary basis, it might be useful to allow a vehicle to drive up to the shelter. It would not be permanent by any means. But just to help make the park more useful, and also really to sort of define what happens where. On the bandstand, we heard concerns that while the bandstand is very historical and it's used frequently, it could be used even more if there was seating that was comfortable. Right now there's a slope in front of the bandstand where if people sit in a chair, it sort of tips, you know, it's not even. So we're looking at ways to put in, again, some more tiered seating there, and to provide an accessible path to the bandstand from Harrison. And one observation we had is that when you're looking at the bandstand, it might be nice to have some flowering trees behind it to buffer the view between the bandstand and the parked cars on the town square, so that if there was a wedding there or other event where a lot of photography was taking place, there would be sort of that pretty screen between the two events. On the playground, we're envisioning all the equipment stays, but we are suggesting that maybe some a low fence might be in order. We have observed and we heard concerns about kids running into the street at times. It would be a playground scale fence. We're also suggesting some flowering trees along to buffer that between the parked cars in the playground, again for a backdrop and to screen those cars. And connect it with that walkway system and perhaps extend the soft playground surface. I think that's primarily the recommendations or preliminary thoughts that we ask for comment on. Any questions from the town council before I move to the next exhibit?
You say a playground fence. What are you talking about?
Probably a 3-foot-high fence that would you could still look over, but it would keep the kids from running into the street. It would have gates, you know, access into it. Does that make sense? Next exhibit. We've also heard on page 2, we discussed some of the concerns that we heard about safety on State Road 9. The need to connect the businesses on the west side of the street or make them more pedestrian accessible to people crossing SR 9. And create methods for the traffic to be traffic or vehicles moving through town to be notified about festivals or town events. It's amazing how many events you have, but unless you're on, you know, some of your online media or it's advertised, the passersby don't know about those events. Also, we've been asked to look at, are there ways to optimize circulation, traffic movements through the square, the walkability and parking, and make sure that we remember that there are farm vehicles that travel SR9 and that there are commercial deliveries, especially to the liquor store in SR9. So we've come up with some initial ideas that we're refining based on the input that we've received. Also, NDOT, we've had an initial meeting with NDOT and town leaders, and NDOT has agreed to do some traffic studies of the intersections to see what kind of turning movements and how many vehicles go through on SR9 versus stay or stay in the town square. So we'll have some better data about what the issues are. Down on the lower half of the sheet, some of the ideas we're exploring are shown. They include looking at a way to stop traffic or slow traffic at the intersections of Washington and Jackson. We've looked at traffic signals, we've looked at stop signs, and we've looked at push button stop signs that stop when a pedestrian pushes it. So those are all sort of on the table for further exploration. We've looked at ways to shorten the pedestrian crossing distance across SR9 right now. SR9 widens when it gets to the square and it becomes, it's right now 80 feet or so wide there of pavement. And that's because it accommodates perpendicular parking, a travel lane for the parking, and then two travel lanes for SR9. And then there's a parking lane on the west side of Main Street. So we're looking at ways, are there ways to put a banner over SR9 to announce these events or other assets about the town? Are there ways to put some, reorganize the perpendicular parking so that the cars aren't backing out into traffic quite so much? So there's sort of a lot of options that we're still exploring and looking at as we get more data from NDOT and as we hear more comments from residents at the public meetings. Any questions about those ideas? Next one, next exhibit. We also asked for input and comment to help us understand the sort of the emphasis on culture and heritage that you'd like in these recommendations. And on this page, we show photos of the existing town clock, some of the existing furnishings like trash receptacles and benches, the quilts, and then we showed potential other options for benches, a more sort of traditional bench with as a cast iron bench with wood slats or an all metal bench. We show different kinds of planters, the trough type planter that you have are putting out now, or a more sturdy iron type planter. We also showed some pictures from Winston-Salem and other Moravian heritage communities that used the star, the Moravian star, or we're calling it the Hope Star, in different ways. And we showed a picture of candle lights, they're probably electric, in the upper windows of upper story windows of the businesses in some of these other historic towns. We also showed a historic preservation sign on the buildings that said the year of the building and what the name of the building was. I think the feedback we got was, we also showed a light fixture from Winston-Salem that was able to accommodate Christmas decorations and a more traditional kind of street sign. We've heard that people would like to have some banners perhaps, or hanging baskets on the lights. The lights right now are controlled by Duke. And they're not installed with foundations. So they're tired, I guess you would say. They're a little, they've been there for 20 plus years. So we're looking at several options for the lights, but we wanted to make sure we understood from people if they supported the idea of some new lights. And I guess quilts, the quilt murals that are on the buildings, we asked if people like those. And basically what we did is we asked people to put dots on the images that they liked the best. And the ones that were supported so far is the clock and the light, the wood bench, or the more sturdy bench, the quilts, the historic signs, the heavier iron planter, and the Hope Star, and the candle lights in the upper windows. A lot of these items can potentially be done without a grant, which is kind of nice. People could choose to go ahead and do some of these things for their business if they wanted to at any time. So that was good feedback to have. Basically, we also heard Hope doesn't want to be Carmel, which we would agree. And we also got a comment back on one of the questionnaires, you don't want to be Nashville either, which I would agree with. The next, I'm sorry, any questions about that?
I'm curious about how many big dots you got beside the brown and yellow benches.
You know, I didn't get any dots there that people like those.
Not surprised.
Yeah, I think that was one of the few common agreement items there. Any other questions, Bob? The next exhibit shows our preliminary work on understanding the architecture around the square. What we did is we took photos and we scaled them so that they relate to the other buildings around the square, and so we could understand the height and massing of the square, where the intrusions are from more modern adaptations or awnings or other items. So we're still working with this to develop some preliminary guidance on for building owners on if they want to update their facades in some way in the future or paint their buildings, what kind of paint colors. So this is a foundation document. This doesn't show recommendations yet, but we'll be bringing those to our committee on Thursday. So there's really no comment there. It does show, though, there's some infill opportunities, particularly the lot on the north side of the square. And it shows how big it is. On the next page, the exhibit, we wanted to get some feedback from people on perhaps some unifying elements around the square. And in our actual presentation or the PowerPoint show, we also showed some paint chips that Chuck Baker had shared with Susan, what they're doing for the access building. And what we wanted to do is get a feeling for what people thought might be appropriate. And in this exhibit that you have in front of you, we were exploring options for awnings. And we like the picture of the existing awnings on the Decker building, which we're calling the Hope Awning. It's a fairly simple shed form, and it's functional. It's not a fabric awning. And we're wondering if that, and we're studying with the architect on our team, Lewis, about possible locations that could fit for this awning in varying heights. It doesn't have to be the same height. It should fit the buildings themselves. But we're also thinking that that might be a way, one of the needs that we heard or issue that we heard was having signs for businesses that relate to the people that are walking on the sidewalks or pedestrian scaled signage. And that might be a place to hang some of that pedestrian scaled signage. And also if the idea of the Hope Star moves forward, that could be a place to put the Hope Star and light that up and make it a special look at night. Generally, we got good responses on the proposed awning style. Any questions from the council on that? So that's sort of an overview of where we are right now. We're working on recommendations that will come out of these preliminary ideas, phasing and funding and priorities. So that we're trying to match these ideas now with potential funding sources or as volunteer items that business owners or residents can do themselves. Looking at what might be incentives instead of maybe there could be grant programs, but they might be based on incentives for people to work together and follow the plan. So that's our next step. So it's going to be an important meeting, and I hope you can come and participate. That'd be great. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, how's your students' presentation, J.T. Dunn, and how's your students?
Yes, honorable council members, we have the team honor tonight. One, I want to acknowledge Mr. Mayer is here, and also Mr. Nobby. They're both here tonight from the school. Appreciate all that you do at the school and welcome to town hall. So without further, are you students ready? Anyone want to go first? So we'll go ahead and get started. We have presentations, and then I will list them off kind of one by one. But our presentations tonight will be from Alicia Pittman, Zoe Holly, Allie Hoover, Naomi Gomer, Layton Wilson, and Annie Ashbrook. So, first on the list, how to boost Hope's economy, Ms. Alicia Pittman.
I do have packets. It's in front area.
Yeah.
IT guy?
Yeah,
here it comes. IT guy was your comment.
He's town marshal, also our IT.
In case you wondered why he had to get one.
I actually purposely corrupted a file just as well.
It's not coming up.
Oh, really?
You're doing a good job.
Yes. I did do a good job, actually. This is just fine. Hello, board members and not board members. My name is Alicia Pittman, and I am a housing student that has been tasked with finding a few ways in which we can boost Hope's economy. As some of you may know, my family, the Schaefers, have roots in Hope history, and I've been a resident all my 17 years, and I've participated and taken an interest in the physical and political renovations of the town. So as qualified as a positionless longtime resident can be, I'm as qualified as they come. So I hope today, because of this, you'll take my word for it, that the ideas I'm about to pitch to you are born of anything but ignorance of the town and its financial history. Not to mention a very basic understanding of what businesses can do for towns like Hope. Now, how about we cut the introductory rambling short and get right to it? Let's talk mini ball. I'm sure you're all pretty familiar with Ferris and Columbus. If you are, you're probably also familiar that it's been struggling for these past few years. The thing is, Ferris had a perfect opportunity to do something great. It's the only well-known mall in that city, and it's right in between two schools. But Ferris made a mistake that this mall is specifically designed to avoid. It didn't appeal to young people. I chose these stores because they're all popular with my generation, and they're just new enough so that they will be popular for several more years, and just old enough to be pulling in an impressive amount of business. I chose places such as Buffalo Wild Wings, Steak and Shake, and Forever 21 because they're specifically popular with the kids of Hope. I mean, really, I think the people at Hauser visit B-Dubs more often than church. I'd like to go into the stores for just a moment, just to clarify some that we may not be familiar with. Charlotte Russe, Zumiez, and Forever 21 are all clothing stores that are popular with younger people. Charlotte Russe is more targeted towards females. The restaurants there, Buffalo Wild Wings, Steak and Shake, and Olive Garden, I mean, we're all pretty familiar with how delicious those are. B-Dubs might be Hope's Vegan's worst nightmare, but that's a sacrifice I'm willing to make. The toy chest there, I don't know how many of you people may have visited this in Nashville, Indiana. There, in this tourist destination, is this toy shop. It may or may not have a special place in my heart. I have a lot of memories at this place as a child, and in all of these memories, this store is packed. And I don't honestly know why it doesn't have a sister location yet, but I feel that Hope would be a good place for it too.
Music and Art Store is a popular music store, but not too many are in Indiana, which would mean drawing a business from, you know, far away. All of these stores would provide amazing opportunities in favor of economic freedom, obviously in employment, also in employees. Not everywhere in Columbus is hiring, and there are people who would drive to work and hope. So the key word here is employment. All the while, this would be working to achieve full employment for Hope. All the while it's doing all these other fantastic, amazing things, we would be working to achieve full employment. The only economic problems I see this mall creating is economic efficiency, but spare material is not really a problem for Hope. Maybe this seems like a lot to you all. Some of you have never heard of many of these stores, and certainly nothing like them has ever been in Hope before. But that's why the current economic state isn't where it could be. I believe it's time for Hope to stop taking baby steps. The only thing keeping us from being a very wealthy little town is apathy from the people in charge of these decisions. Moderate amounts of concern are understandable, but the town has been at a financial standstill for years, or at least appear so. I and my classmates are here today because the board says they have a legitimate interest in our ideas to better Hope economically. I respectfully encourage you to prove it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Miss Alicia Pittman. Next on the list, I was told by one student that I had to skip and go to the next one, so I told her, I said I thought it was better just to go ahead and go through it. But so next on the list is Hope Town Mall, Small Community, Big Businesses, Miss Annie Ashbrook.
Good evening, all. Unlike Alicia, I don't have a PowerPoint, but I have some notes on my phone, so that's why I'm going to be looking down. I'm not texting my friends or anything, so I apologize in advance for the distraction about that. But like we've been talking about all this evening, Hope is getting revitalized. Hope is a new generation, like my children, like me, my friends, like your children. It's the next generation. So what is the next generation going to bring to Hope to better develop the economy and boost the growth in the community? Well, I'd like to share some ideas with you all today that I have that we can bring to our community to develop it, bring growth within our population and growth within our economy. First, I'd like to start off with the mall itself. The mall itself is going to be a 9-story building, which is going to consist of the top 5 floors dedicated to housing. Now, housing is a huge issue here in Hope as we struggle to find homes for the elderly people. According to the Indiana Census of 2010, 20% of Hope's population is between the ages of 55 and 90. These people will have the prime opportunity to live in these housing additions above businesses, which will benefit them. These homes will also include Section 8 housing, which will benefit the lower income population of Hope. Another thing is that Hope has a 3.8 unemployment rate. This is also according to the Indiana Census of 2010. This 3.8 unemployment rate will be diminished by bringing in the businesses that I have thought of to support our community. Not only will jobs be available through these apartments, but jobs will be available through the food, the retail stores, and the miscellaneous businesses that I've thought of. Some stores that I've thought of would be a Whole Foods store. Many of you have probably heard of Whole Foods. It's a popular store which is in bigger cities. There's one, I believe, up in Greenwood. And this focuses on healthy alternative food for people. I think this is very important here in Hope, as we used to have local grocery stores and that sort of thing. But like I mentioned earlier, a large population of Hope is elderly people. They're struggling to drive into Columbus, to drive into Shelbyville, to get fresh food. By bringing in a Whole Foods store in our town mall, they're going to be able to go from their apartment on the fifth floor to the Whole Foods store on the first floor to get bananas, milk, bread, whatever else they could need that they can't get at Dollar General. Along with this would be an antique mall. There used to be an antique mall right here on the square, which I know I personally loved, but it went away. By bringing something like this back, we can not only bring back memories, but make new ones by allowing vendors to set up personal shops and sell their goods to the community, excuse me. Our last business would be a clothing boutique. This is something that's super popular right now. And like Alicia previously mentioned, by having the younger generation have options for somewhere they can shop, it will bring in more and more business and bring younger people into Hope. A clothing boutique could be anything. There are many different types of clothing boutiques, but one here in Hope that would fit perfectly well is the Western style. This is something that is super popular right now among girls, and it would do wonderful. So along with these retail stores, we would provide food and entertainment. The food and entertainment industry is booming right now with places like Dave & Buster's, Starbucks Coffee, and frozen yogurt shops. Hope already provides great options of food, but by adding these three into the list and into the mall, we would have way more for people. Finally, is something that I thought we could do to provide space for more jobs and more employment, excuse me. This would be office spaces. This would be an entire floor dedicated for offices. Lawyers, doctors, counselors, anyone like that who would need an office could have a space. This would bring in business and allow for more people to share their knowledge with the community. As me and my fellow students share ideas with you tonight, I know this isn't something that's gonna happen immediately. I know we're not going to build a nine-story mall before I leave for college in the fall, but I hope that you take our ideas into consideration to help bring us back into the community and to bring our friends from Lafayette, Muncie, and wherever else we may be back here in Hope. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Annie Ashbrook. Next on the list, Economic Development for Hope, Mr. Clayton Wilson.
Hi, I'm Clayton Wilson. I'm a senior at Hauser. And for my economic project for econ class, we had to do three types of stores or businesses, and there were the restaurants, retail stores, and services. And the goals for my project were to bring more people into Hope and bring more business without changing it too much and doing anything too extravagant. And I did have three restaurants to add, but I thought the one that would impact Hope most would be a fast food restaurant, which is very popular in kids and people that are in a hurry, because everybody's in a hurry nowadays. And I think that would help bring a lot of jobs and a lot of people out to eat. And we already do have plenty of places to eat, but we don't have a fast food place, so I think that would be a great addition to Hope. And we also, or I had a retail store that I was to add to Hope. And I thought that the best retail store to add would be a shoe store, like a Nike, or any other shoe store that you can find in a mall. And I think that the shoe store would bring in people out, and we wouldn't have to travel all the way to Edinburgh outlet malls or places in Columbus to find shoes, and it would bring more people here. And the last one was the service business that I think we should add to Hope. And the most important I think that we should add is entertainment business. And entertainment is a big part nowadays, but there are many entertainment businesses out there in Columbus, like bowling alleys and laser tag and places like that. And I think a bowling alley is one option that we could add. And we could really add just any business that would help bring entertainment to to Hope. And sorry, mine's not very long, but to conclude, I just think that we should bring a few more stores in to help change Hope and make it so people don't have to travel all the way to Columbus or to Edinburgh, and just help people get out in Hope more and not have to drive to Columbus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Clayton Wilson. Next up on the list, Hope Outlet Mall by Ms. Allie Hoover.
Hi, my name is Allie Hoover and I'm a senior at Hauser, and like Clayton, I don't really like public speaking. I'm not like Alicia, it's not gonna be very long. But for econ projects, we had to pick 9 businesses, retail food or services, that we, as kids, would decide to bring to Hope. I've been asked a lot personally, like, what are my plans after graduating college, and if I plan to return to Hope, and I have considered it, and I do fully agree that Hope is a very great town to raise a family in, but Hope also doesn't have a lot of options to, I guess, bring up a family besides school and sports and everything. One of my services that I chose that I think would be a great idea to add to Hope is an Aldi store. I don't know how many people shop at Aldi's, but I know a lot of, like my family, a lot of family friends that I know shop at Aldi's. And for people that don't know, Aldi's is smaller than Walmart, but it is bigger than the dollar store. And unlike the dollar store, it doesn't overprice their items like the dollar store does. It's not too big and it offers a huge variety of foods. And another bonus to adding in Aldi's is that they provide food for pets, toiletries, and baby and food products like diapers and wipes. They also provide produce and meats, which the dollar store does not offer, and we no longer have the Hope Market to provide these items for us. And we do have Swiss Made, but as far as I know, it's only like deli meats and stuff. But I think that this would be a great idea for people, I mean, on the go, like cookouts and stuff, like somebody needs hamburger or steaks or chicken, or even like corn on the cob or tomatoes, this would be a great addition to the Hope area. As a senior, you know, you're always looking for things to do that you'll remember before you go off to college and say that you actually got to do in high school. And I fully believe that there's not a lot to do in Hope. I mean, you have like your Friday night basketball games, like we don't have a football team, so we're not like Columbus, how we got to say, like, we got to attend Friday Night Lights and, you know, stuff like that. But, like Clayton, I think that there are, I guess, like, I don't know, fun things we could add to the Hope area to bring people back. And one of those things, I know this may seem totally unrealistic, but a Dave & Buster's, I don't know if anybody's been there, it's like a giant arcade. I think this would be a great addition to the Hope area. I mean, it's mainly directed towards kids. But, and the closest one I believe is on the north side of Greenland, so closer to Indy. But adding this, like, it could provide for birthday parties, places for people to like, gather, like, after games, instead of driving to Columbus to go to, like, Applebee's or Buffalo Wild Wings. It's just a place to, like, hang out. And, I mean, it is kind of directed towards one age group, but I feel like, you know, as kids, it's kind of nice to be able to hang out with your friends and do something that you'll always remember and have fun doing. For my retail business, I kind of went with a bigger business because I think it would be different to have something big in Hope since it is such a small town. And I actually chose to maybe consider a Kohl's or something like a retail store that can provide for everyone and not just one specific gender or age group. And if we brought a Kohl's to the Hope area, we would be meeting the needs for babies, children, men, and women. Kohl's provides many items, anywhere from clothes and shoes to kitchen appliances and house and bathroom decorations. Kohl's always has sales, so it's not too overpriced, and most of the time, people will be able to find what they came for. It's a great store to add to our area, and it will save many people trips to Columbus or Greenland. I'm understand that this process can be very overwhelming, and I would like to thank you all for taking your time to listen to my personal opinion about how we can improve our surprising little town. I am fully on board to adding 9 or even 3 or even 1 new business to our community, and I really hope that many of you would take this into consideration, whether it's mine or any of my other fellow classmates. Our community is growing slowly, but it is getting bigger, and we can see this every day. And so thank you again for your time, and hopefully you'll take this into consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Allie Hoover. Next up, Hope Development Plan by Ms. Naomi Gomer.
Hello, I'm Naomi Gomer, and if you don't recognize my name or face, it's because I actually moved here 2 years ago, so I'm fairly new to this community. But over the years, I have really grown to love this community, and they were so welcoming in the beginning, and they still are. And as much as I love it, I would really, really love to see more development come to Hope. So I'm going to share with you my main goals and then my ideas for Hope. So part of the reason I love Hope is because of the small town charm. And I think that's why they were so welcoming in the beginning. And I really want to bring in businesses that show off this charm. So I don't really want to bring in big businesses like Kohl's or something that you find in a mall. I want to focus on what we already have and just make it better. So I also want to bring in more employment, which could be hard keeping the businesses smaller, but since we had to focus on 3 different areas, the retail, the food, and the service, I came up with some pretty good ideas, I think. So first, I want to bring in a harvest market or some sort of grocery store where you can buy produce and meat. And I think a lot of people had that idea. I know, especially with my parents, they're like, oh man, it would be really nice if we could just run into Hope and go to Dollar General and another grocery store to get produce. So this would also provide jobs for adults and also teenagers. I have a job, and I have to drive to Columbus, which is 30 minutes away from my house. So that kind of takes a toll on you after a while. So it would be really nice to have somewhere to work in Hope. For my food businesses, I thought of a cafe or bakery. Now, I do work at Starbucks, so I might be a little biased, but I really would like to have a cafe or bakery in Hope. It'd be a unique job, and it would also be a nice place to go before or after work or school or wherever you have to be, and it would also be a really nice place to meet up if you have a project to work on or just anything that you want to hang out with your friends. Another idea I had was a food truck, which might sound a little strange, but I think it would really bring something unique to Hope, because when you think of a small town, you think of restaurants, but a food truck would be kind of like, oh, like, it kind of seems like, I think it would really bring in something like Heritage Days and just, you know, keep that in your mind. And lastly, for services, I really would like to see a movie theater put in Hope. Just a small one, nothing huge, but I think it would bring in a lot of jobs for any age group. And it would also attract the young generation, for sure, because I go and see a movie every month, at least, or more. And lastly, a preschool or a daycare. And I think that would really help develop Hope's youth and bring them up right, for sure. I had a site map in my binder, and I wanted to include a park and a picnic area in this place that we're building it, and also restrooms. And that's, I know we talked about that earlier there, but we don't have that on the square. You have to go somewhere else. So I think restrooms would be a very good idea. And also lots of landscape and flowers, and just make it really nice and homey, for sure. I personally believe Hope is a great town, and I don't want to change everything about it. I think development should happen, but it's also nice to see that people care and people come and do something like this to try and talk about it. So thank you for considering all our ideas, and we really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Naomi Gomer. Next on the list, Making Hope Better, Zoe Hoff.
Hi,
9 places, and so I'm just going to pick the 3 main places that I think are mostly important, and I will talk about them. I chose daycare because I feel like here lately a lot of girls kind of getting pregnant, and they're really young, so I think it's very important for them to at least further their education for being a high school student as well, and they can't really do that if their kid's on their mind. And so a daycare would be nice to drop them off, still go to school, and continue on with what they were originally supposed to be doing. And my second place is I chose a cafe. I know that we already have a cafe, but I was thinking more like a coffee shop kind of thing where something really subtle, have some nice music. You can go there to start out your day, go there to end your day. Nice little entertainment and just nice place to get together, talk, chill out, be with your friends. And then my third place is an art club or like an art store type thing. I feel like we can bring a lot of creativity to Hope. I know that it's already creative, but like have people further their education on art maybe. I know that I like art. Really nice reliever, and I think that people don't really pay attention to it as much as they could have because they don't really understand it. Maybe if we had a store that could teach like 2D, 3D, sculpting, photography, dancing, just all kinds of different genres of art, kind of get people familiar with it and realize it's really good for a town to communicate with it. And that's just the 3 places I chose.
Thank you, Ms. Zoe Hollick, and just this is obviously an example of how blessed we are as a community, as I pointed out, to have these students get up here, and it's not easy, but you got up here, and the way you articulated, the way you put your thoughts together, you can tell your house are Jets. Is that accurate? So, Mr. Hobby, Mr. Mayor, thank you. Students, thank you. We appreciate it. Thank you.
I appreciate it. Everyone I've done met Annie Ashbrook. I certainly hope you get that building over there because I am at the age where I would love to have one of those apartments and have my food down here and my doctor take me up. It was wonderful. Thank you very much.
All more council members, any other comments?
Yeah, I'd like to compliment you on your job this evening. You've done a great job. But I also want to challenge you. I heard somebody say they didn't know whether they'd come back to Hope or not. One way to make it better, that's for you to come back and to help put it together.
That's right.
Any other comments from the council?
Yeah, I would like to agree with the rest of the council of the tremendous idea. Tremendous. I do want you to also realize that this council is working to make this town to the point that we can draw these people to the town. So if you see the roads being blacktopped, waters being done, it takes that to draw all these businesses to the town. But your ideas are just truly, truly great.
Thank you.
Miller?
Well, I'm not the teacher, but I think all these kids deserve an A. I think it's quite a commitment for them to come up here and get up and talk to a bunch of strangers, people they don't know, people they're not familiar with. I really applaud them, and I'm really appreciative of their effort and the commitment they've made here tonight. And I think they have great ideas, and that's just the beginning. Your ideas and the next part is to put it into action. Thank you so much.
Are there any other comments? I guess the only final comment is that obviously you can talk from the council, there's a consensus that we hope that you come back to Hope.
Okay. Audit adjustment resolution 2017-02, Diane Berger. Princess Diana.
Well, as you know, we did have an audit at the first of the year, actually a little bit at the end of the year and on into the first of the year. The audit was for 12, 13, 14, and 15. This resolution audit adjustments is from 2012. So these adjustments have been approved by the State Board of Accounts, and now I will need the council approval in order to make these adjustments. So this is resolution 2017-02, audit adjustments. Be it ordained by the Council of the Town of Hope that the following balance adjustments of funds as a result of administrative bookkeeping errors by the Treasurer in office during the term of 2008 to 2012. So all of these are reductions. General fund is $3,921.79. Water fund is $575.49. Sewer fund, $473.49. Payroll fund, $2,689.39. Water savings, $13.57. Water debt reserves, $5.01. The wastewater was actually a grant that had 3 cents left in there, and they said we just could go ahead and take care of that as well. So the total is $7,678.77.
Motion. Got a motion, got a second. Got a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carried.
Thank you.
Okay, looks like it's me. Get it. We had a whole slew of them this time. Let the council keep in mind that every one of them was unanimously approved, so I don't have to keep saying it over and over again. The first one I'm going to go with is Farmers Market of Hope. They requested $1,200 for entertainment, $800 for promotional and miscellaneous. Of course, that totals $2,000. So we have a motion, we have a second. Do we have any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries 5-0. The second one is the Yellow Trail Museum. Before I proceed any further, I did check to make sure that Ed Johnson was not on the Yellow Trail board, which he is not. He is totally able to vote on any of these items. So, anyway, Hill Trail Museum Visitors Information Center, which is being moved over there. They requested a total of $1,400. They have a estimated cost of remodeling for the visitors at $4,314. We discussed this. We almost lost the visitor center. We were lucky that it's being put in by the Yellow Trail Museum, which will also let the Yellow Trail Museum stay open 4 hours. And so instead of the $1,400, we voted to grant them $2,500 to get started. So we got a motion, we got a second. Any discussion?
I'm going to abstain. That's all right.
So do you have to? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carried 4-0. Okay. Another one here from our museum for the old fashioned Independence Day celebration. Fund every year. The total for everything will end up being $6,650. They requested $4,500. And again, it was unanimous. We give them $4,500. Do I have any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries
David Webster. See here. Bart, can you explain this little interactive thing a little more about it?
I'll do my best. Several years ago, Mike Watson made a model of the Hopetown Square in the 1930s and 40s. And it has been circulated throughout town in various locations, and it's now permanently located in the Old Trail Museum. Before he passed away, he and Merrill Klaus made a recording about all the businesses on the town square, telling what they could remember about each of the buildings. And so it sort of matches. However, the recording they made takes 75 minutes to play. And it was quite obvious that people were not going to come in and stand and look at this model for 75 minutes. So before I passed away, he said, I do hope that we can somehow shorten this, make it so that people can request a story about various businesses on the square so that they don't have to listen to the whole thing. We have a young man by the name of Ben Cleland who is interested in creating almost like a video game. It's going to have a little handheld control that would allow people to go to the third business on the west side of the square, punch the button, and find out about that business. Move on around the square and locate something else they're interested in and find the story of that. And so basically, that's what we're looking at. We're looking at our first ever interactive display at the Old Trail Museum. That's the way of the future, having people have something to do when they come in and look at things. And so it may be an experiment, but I really think it'll be worthwhile. So that's what our request is all about.
And that request is for up to $3,500. We have a motion, we have a second, do we have discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries. One more. Susan Verify from Main Street. We have the executive director's salary part-time. $10,816. Rent over at the Old Trail Museum is $100 a month, and for 9 months, of course, it's $900. The cleanup for the fall is $900, and disposal of tires from the cleanup is $500. The spring cleanup has already been approved, and the beautification projects has already been approved. So anyway, the total funding is $21,016. Again, it was unanimous to go with it. Motion second. Any discussion?
Is there not any money through Main Street for any of that?
Not right now. We may be able to do something next year, but very, very little. I'm not sure where it came from either.
I thought there was somebody in Main Street that paid the salary. Wasn't there at the beginning?
It was, I think it was originally from Ed.
Yeah, it was from Ed. Yeah, okay.
Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. That's all I've got on it. Town Square.
Yes, honorable council members, here 2 weeks ago on a Friday, our previous Mr. Watson came in and said he was unable to continue to do the trash on the square effective immediately. He said he came in on a Friday. So we, in the last couple weeks, have you know, let's see what options we have. With the trash cans, having someone come in, take the trash bags out, put trash bags in. I did reach out to some of the contractors, and it just wasn't something that they really wanted to provide as far as someone coming in. Because we have currently 19, and actually have one additional over near the utility garage, so we actually have 20 cans. I personally experienced this last week. Our utility members, Jeremy and Zach, and I also brought some bib overalls to town and put on over my usual attire, and we took care of the trash last week and got that taken care of. I was able to speak to Mr. Jeff Yarnell. I spoke to him and reached out to him about if he knew of anyone that would have an interest in potentially doing the trash on the square. Again, it's roughly about 20 cans. And he himself said he had an interest. I had that discussion with him. The previous amount that we had budgeted for was for $200, was what we were paying before. Mr. Yarnell said he would do it for the $200, and we also appropriated in a contract I'm going to pass around to you momentarily for $50 per month for the bags. We did look at the cost of the bags, and looking at 20 bags being replaced. I spoke with Mr. Yarnell in the past. There were times where our trash cans, I know by Councilmember Miller's office, would get full. So I did request to him if he could do it on a weekly basis, on either potentially Thursday or Friday of the week. And then in the event we have functions or events on the weekends, if he could also do it on a Monday as well, to make sure that our trash cans are clean on the square for the upcoming week. He agreed to be able to do that, and he was able to do that. Is in agreement to do it for, again, the $200 that we had previously budgeted for the town square trash. And he also was, felt that the $50 for bags on a monthly basis would cover the bags that he would purchase. He was not able to be here tonight. In fact, when I spoke to him prior to your council meeting, he actually was mowing. He's not had an opportunity to sign the contract. I'll leave it to the council as to whether he said he could come by in the morning to sign. I'll leave it to the council as to whether you would like to take a look at the contract, proceed to sign, and then have him sign in the morning, or if you would prefer that I get his signature, and then I can get your signatures. And I can go ahead, too, and just kind of and pass this contract through, but it reads as follows. Whereas the town of Hope, Indiana desires to contract for trash services on the town square. Whereas the town of Hope has determined its needs, the services of Mr. Jeff Yarnell. Now therefore, the town of Hope, Indiana, by and through its town council, hereby entering a contract for services with Jeff Yarnell as follows. The town of Hope, Indiana, agrees to compensate Jeff Yarnell for a fee of $250 to retrieve the trash on the town square and place trash bags therein through December 31st of 2017. And while rendering these services for the town of Hope, he shall be covered by the town's liability insurance. We spoke with Council Member Miller earlier this afternoon to get that clarification as far as his coverage when he is conducting that work on the square. Jeff Yarnell agrees to retrieve trash and replace trash bags therein on a weekly basis on either Thursday or Friday. Jeff Yarnell also agrees to retrieve trash on the town square and replace trash bags as the need arises following events and or functions held on the town square on Monday. And then lastly, if either party desires to terminate this contract for services, a notice in writing 30 days in advance if said termination is necessary.
Do we need to have a motion before we discuss it?
There was no contract originally. I mean, I don't know.
Should we not have all contracts go to our attorney?
Well, it was emailed to me this week, and I did have a chance to speak with JT about it and voice the concern about insurance was not mentioned in it, and I'm glad to hear that the town can cover the general liability. It sounds like what
he would fall under the same category as Potts, Mr. Potts, who does provide service for us within the constraints of the town.
I guess what concerns me is the other part of that is if he would get injured doing his work on our property. It doesn't have any workers' comp insurance. I would not like to see the town become liable, and I do have some other clients where that has been an issue.
We could ask him to sign a release on the workers' comp.
What would you suggest?
Well, and if there is a way to deal with that, but it needs to be dealt with, I think, because particularly with more manual kind of work and lifting and stuff. Well, I don't know. I've not had an opportunity to look into that. And I guess my other thought
is that the $250 need, and maybe I just missed it, specified, is that monthly?
Yes.
And when's it payable? Or does it, and whether or not invoices need to be submitted for that?
Yes, invoices, and it would go in with our regular claims.
And I mean, I don't want to make it into like a hyper complicated contract, but the insurance part does concern me.
Well, I don't speak for the entire council, but speaking for myself, I do believe that we need an attorney to handle these kinds of things, and I would hope that our contracts do go through Cindy, anything that we ask, because that's, you know, that's why we have an attorney to take care of that for us.
So I'm just not personally familiar with signing a workman's comp release. If that's been done in other cases that you know of, then, you know, I'll rely on your expertise in that area.
There is a form on the state of Indiana website that we can pull, and it's just release for workman's comp.
Like I said, I'm not familiar with it, so.
Okay. Why don't we let him see if he'll sign that release and that contract before we sign it?
Okay.
Just to make sure.
And Cindy, I think I will need a motion since it's an interim contract.
Yeah.
So maybe with condition that the workers' comp release is signed, or what would you have in there?
I think yes, and I'll also pull it up and take a look at it too. I think we had some simple language in there about submitting invoices for payment too. That will help you out, I think, with state board accounts.
Okay.
It's the release is online.
Okay.
We need to vote on this, you said?
Yeah, I think approved pending.
Okay, can I make a motion?
Sure.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we allow Mr. Garnell to perform his duties based on his ability to sign release of workman's comp, and that he will provide monthly invoices and comply with all the other requirements of the account. Wow. You don't put wow.
Got a motion to have a second.
Also what?
Got a second. Jerry. Okay, now we discuss.
Yes, I do have a question. What, I mean, we're talking about letting him go ahead and do this before Cindy looks into it and gets this done, or?
I would say no.
Should we not? That's what I was going to say. We shouldn't go ahead and let him do anything until Cindy gives us an approval, right?
This could be pending her approval.
Her approval, okay.
So once she
says. But I thought we were talking like he was going to go ahead and start if he would sign this paper, but I want to get Cindy's.
We have to sign.
Well, I guess I defer for what you were saying.
Okay, motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries 5-0. Okay, town manager report.
All right, just a few updates to update the community on. One, if you had an opportunity, the Hope Wellness Pharmacy is open. We have an opening on April 3rd, so if you haven't had an opportunity to go and discuss with them, please do, about transferring where you have been, or just speak with them about different services that they have. You'll be seeing some paving in town if you haven't already. O'Meara's in town doing some paving on the community crossing matching grants. If you recall, those are the two grants that were awarded from NDOT back in August, the amount of $57,332, which was a matching grant. And so you will be seeing some paving going on in the near future, and we'll be doing some sidewalk work. Again, that animal shelter fund's out there, the Paul A. Paul from Board of Animal Shelter Fund. If you have any interest in making any donations, again, those would be greatly appreciated. 154 Elm Street property, which was on the agenda for quite some time, did go to closing. Council President Compton and I attended that closing for that property. Mr. Randy Page will purchase that property. I arranged a lunch, and today had a very positive lunch with United Way. We spoke about the community and some opportunities that could come where they could help residents. They are very eager to help. They're going to get me over some information. They're going to get me some applications and some other details. But I had a very good lunch and a very good discussion with them. They will be in town on May the 5th. They had already prearranged. I know of at least one home that they will be at and be helping on May the 5th. And again, we talked about some other ways and opportunities that they could help some of our residents. So as I receive more information, I will share that and get that obviously to the town council and also share with the public as well. Our grant administrator, Ms. Trina Carter, spoke of the town hall and that where that process is. Of course, we spoke about the water tower. Folks, Student Enrichment Committee met back on April the 6th. I have a conference coming up with the Indiana Municipal Management Association. It'll be coming up later this month that I'll be attending. I want to thank Mr. Patton, Mr. Chuck Baker on the work that's been done over at the Accent Building. And if you have a chance to go over and look at some of the changes, we're talking to Mr. Patton and Mr. Baker about some of their plans they have for that. Our Economic Growth Task Force met again this week. I'm pleased to announce that we've made some initial decisions on looking into housing, some potential housing options. We discussed some land around here. We're at one point, the comprehensive plan discussions were about possible housing. So we're currently reaching out to one on some senior living, and then also two on potentially some other housing developments. So that is a direction that the Growth Task Force has decided that we want to look into. And I'll have more details at your May council meeting, as we've already set a meeting for the 1st of May to discuss that further. That is a direction that we've decided to look at for our community. We talked about the garbage and rubbish ordinance. And again, I have a spreadsheet prepared that kind of tracks that and keeps, and it's something that's a public share. So that way our clerk treasurer, our town marshal, and our building zone administrator can all see that file. So we all can keep track of dates and follow that timeline. Next radio show, May the 4th at 8:30, WCSI. We had an Easter egg hunt here on the square on Thursday. The community center came down for an Easter egg hunt. I also have a meeting coming up on Thursday with a Mr. John Myers with Indiana Small Business. Has reached out to see where things are in the community and possibly suggest some ideas or provide some resources to help our business community. And then lastly, I attended the graduation for our Deputy Marshal Adam Mathis, and here towards the end of the agenda, you'll get to hear a little bit more from our Town Marshal Matt Talon about that. Thank you.
Two other things.
Yes, sir.
Number one, we need to let them know that you and Matt are going to that drug seminar tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Would you like to go ahead and comment on that, Council President?
Yes.
Tomorrow evening, Town Marshal Talent and I will be attending. Some of you may have seen some press on, there's been a kind of a task force organized to look at the opiate problem that we're having in communities. And tomorrow evening, Town Marshal Talent and I will be attending that event to get some information from how, we could potentially have that in our community directly, and also to see what other communities are doing. Because again, we are not the only community that is faced with this sad sad problem. So I look forward to attending that tomorrow evening with Town Marshal Talent.
The other thing, and there's copies up here for anybody, I don't know if you've seen in the paper that he's part of you. Trying to get rate increase.
yes, to comment a little further on Council President Compton's statement, up here on the corner, there are some documents, and that was what was sent to me by the OUCC that are encouraging comments from, you know, all those that you know, have any comment they want to make. The deadline is May the 9th to get those comments to them. So this sheet's up here. It kind of has direction, has a phone number you can contact and some other information. If you have any difficulties at all in trying to submit your comments to them, please let me know here at Town Hall, and I'll be glad to call in and indicate some problems that you may be having. They encouraged the comments, and so I definitely want to encourage you to make those comments, to take that opportunity to let them know what your concerns are with this. And as Council President Compton indicated, Utility Superintendent David Klaus and I have already calendared to attend that hearing June the 28th. It'll be up in Indy to be there for that hearing. Any additional information that we receive in the interim, I will make sure to share accordingly.
You might share what they're asking for a little bit.
They're currently seeking a very high percentage. If I recall, I believe it was about 44% increase. And again, this is what East Bartholomew is requesting to increase their water rate across their clients. Again, I don't have any other details as far as specifics. I do feel that they might have went asked a little high, knowing that they may have to be a little less. But again, as of right now, what they have submitted is for the 44% increase on the water. So I encourage you as the community to please take that opportunity to respond. Take the opportunity to respond. Again, it's by May the 9th, and if you have any problems at all, please contact me at Town Hall. I'll be glad to reach out and indicate that you're having problems, whether it be through email or call. I'll be glad to help and assist in any way I can.
Thank you. We wait for life. Joanna, I should please.
Good evening, Council. My name is Donna Shepherd, and I'm with the Relay for Life of Hope. And I am requesting approval to use the town square on June the 3rd from 8 a.m. until 11 p.m., although it'll probably be midnight as people are cleaning up and stuff. And then also on Friday, June the 2nd, in the evening, we will set up. So I'm just asking if this will be our eighth year, if you approve that we use the town square for the relay. We're having Hartsville's doing a fish fry. The Hope Fire Department is going to be our medical aid. And we're going to have music, games, just all kinds of things going on. There'll be a bike ride, kickstands up at 12:30. My son heads that up, Jason Gerhardt. And I don't know if it's okay, if it's official, if I ask Mr. Talent. Normally, the police, we have a police escort for the motor civil
right. Right, we get permission from the council every year to make sure we lead them. They go through Decatur County, and you know, I don't know the route this year yet. But,
yeah, I don't either.
But we will get with all the communities we go through and make sure they know we're leading the motorcycle right through.
And it's worked out really well in the past. It just helps keep things, not that anything's gonna get out of control or anything, but it helps to know that we have a police officer in the group.
So as long as you guys don't have a problem with it, we can get it set up whenever he gets with them.
And they check their dates with you?
Yes. And I've noticed that in the past, since we've been doing this, Columbus has been trying to kind of do the same thing, but they've always had it at North on the school track. That's normally where you have it. But we've got a beautiful downtown. area with a park where the kids, I mean, because this is a long day, and it used to be an overnight event, a 24-hour event. So I've noticed they've been doing different parks in Columbus also, so I feel like that it's just, we just have such a surprising little town. I want to add one more thing, it doesn't have anything to do with the relay, but as the students were talking about all of this, I mean, they've got all these high hopes and stuff, but it brought me back to my teen years, and I just remember growing up here in Hope, and it sounds like they just want a place to hang out, a place that's safe for them to hang out. I guess it was safe. I'm still alive. But we have the town square. We would park on the town square. There may be some others here who used to do that, and we would just hang out. Do what? We just used to hang out, and even though my dad may not know this, but at 1 o'clock in the morning, we're on the north side of the square playing Frisbee in the street. There's nobody there, you know. So, but those are just fond memories that I have, and so I really respect their ideas and stuff, and that some may be a little far-fetched, but that's what we need for Hope to keep this town going. So thank you, Council.
I just wanted to take a minute to recognize Adam Mathis. Adam started the Indiana Law Enforcement Academy in January of this year and graduated April 7th. Adam had a 97.2 average while at the academy, which put him second in his class. He was 0.7% away from graduating first in his class. So I wanted to take a minute to recognize Adam for his achievement in graduating the academy. And that's all I have. Mr. Nobby, correct me if I'm wrong, he never did that well in any of your classes.
You should have great.
Thank you.
Okay, do we have any questions or comments about our submitted reports?
Yes, I didn't know. I assume you've read Greg's report, and it sounds like he's having issues with what he does. I don't know how many hours he works, but have you read his report?
I did, yes, and he actually went out this week, so I had our opportunity to kind of discuss that further with him.
Okay, yeah, I didn't know what he was meaning for us to do about this, so I just physically can't do as much as people are asking them to do, so I didn't know.
I'm planning the council to meet with the building administrator Potts, and then I could let you know what his comments are.
It just take longer to do it, I guess. I mean, I don't know if that's what you're meaning or not. But yes, if you would, I appreciate it.
Yes.
Anything else? Any public comments? Yes, sir.
I would just like to thank Mr. Doan and the town council. Appreciate you letting us come tonight and the students to share their thoughts. I know we're genuinely excited that you guys are interested in what they have to say and what their opinions are and what they'd like to see. And I think hopefully they were excited about the project, but I think more so that they might be able to be a little bit involved in how Hope progresses and how Hope changes. And I know they appreciated the opportunity to come here and share that with you, knowing that you were truly interested. So I thank you, sir, and I do thank the council for letting us have that opportunity.
Well, they are the future. Yes, sir, Randy.
This be Hope Planning Commission. The commissioners appointed Rick Flores liaison for Hope Planning Commission of the county. There's a letter on the dying.
Okay. Did you guys like well as
I think there's like they were last year.
Might check on that. Anything else?
I have a comment.
Okay.
This week we have lost one of our city fathers. Merrill Klaus, to name one of there's several that we've lost this year. Merrill Klaus, Ike Wasson. These are city fathers. And these gentlemen, they are responsible in part a lot for what we are doing here today. And as a councilman, I would like to, I guess, unofficially thank them for their effort. And I don't know how else to put that, but just because of what they did, we're here today. And it's a blessing. And we can't, I can't even imagine the hours that those gentlemen put in to support this community.
And it was all always unselfishly done. And anyone who knows Merrill knows that he just gave and gave and gave. And he enjoyed doing it. He was, well, he was just happy. And
he started the bar department. He started Heritage Days. We nicknamed things. And I remember when he lost that.
He was just someone that everyone enjoyed and everyone liked.
Nothing else, meeting's adjourned.